Let's talk about Truth or Dare, which is the latest horror film from Blumhouse Productions. Now, Blumhouse Productions is a really interesting operation. It's kind of a boutique studio that makes a lot of low-budget films, mainly but not exclusively horror. And they have a very high turnover rate. All of them are very low-budget. And because of this, the films that hit will more than pay for the films that don't. And so they can afford to be quite ambitious and quite innovative when they want to be. And it's given rise to films like Whiplash and most notably Get Out. These are both Blumhouse films. And I think because of the very peculiar business model of the studio, it gives rise to those kind of films and allows them to develop organically against this kind of backdrop of films like Paranormal Activity, Insidious, The Purge, Sinister. These are the films that keep the studio ticking over.
Right.
Now, Truth or Dare is a textbook bad Blumhouse film because the premise of it sounds like a very good idea. And I think you have to kind of make this film in order to work out that, no, it's not a very good idea at all. It's directed by Jeff Wadlow, who his last film was Kick-Ass 2. It's a teen-centric horror. And it's one of those teen-centric horrors where the premise is something scary that you can easily recreate in your own house. So Ouija, which was a Blumhouse film recently, or even a film like Nightmare on Elm Street, you know, where this idea that all you have to do in order to be stalked by this demonic character is fall asleep, or Candyman, you know, you just stand in front of the mirror and say Candyman 5 times. These are things that teenage viewers of these films can sort of toy with doing by themselves at home and, you know, become scared and spooked out by the film even after they've stopped watching it. So that's the kind of premise. You have a haunted game of truth or dare where people who join in with this game are sort of possessed, taken into the control of the thrall of this demon at the heart of the game called Kallax. And the demon will give you the choice of truth or dare. You have to respond truth or dare. He then doles out a forfeit, and you either have to comply with that forfeit pretty much immediately, regardless of how humiliating or grisly it is, or the demon will possess you and force you to kill yourself in some horrific way.
Awesome.
That's the premise, okay? And here we can see a round of that, or here we can hear, rather, a round of that game in action.
Okay.
Truth or dare? Dare. Dare you to follow through with your promise. Break Olivia's hand. Obviously this was you.
Marky, why would I dare you to break my own hand?
I don't know! What are you doing?
You have to do it.
What?
You have to. Ronnie didn't do his dare, and now he's dead.
There's no way I'm gonna break your hand.
Well, you don't really have a choice. So just take it, please.
Marky, I don't wanna find out what happens if you don't.
Just do it. Just do it.
Crunch.
Crunch.
Right. So, and it was Olivia's played by Lucy Hale. She's the sensible member of the group, Lucy Hale from Pretty Little Liars. Now, at first, the film works exactly as you would expect, and it's actually quite good. It's got the various truths or dares are geared to kind of cause maximum discomfort to teens. It's about confessions in front of, you know, people that should be hearing things or people you don't want to hear things. And it plays it silly sometimes with the breaking of the hand. It also plays it serious sometimes too. One of the kids is gay and he hasn't come out to his dad yet. So the dare is that he has to come out to his father. So it's kind of, it's engaged with teenage life and this kind of not wanting to, in the same way that the real game of truth or dare is so appealing to teens for that specific reason. It's this idea of having to humiliate yourself on a stage, you know, on literally on pain of death. The problem is, just as, you know, you start turning that premise over in your head, you realise there's a lot of loopholes. So, for example, it'd be very easy for all the players to just sit in a room where there's nothing dangerous and keep asking for truths. And then they just have to be honest to each other and it's, you know, it doesn't necessarily go out with the room. So the film has to keep on closing these loopholes by introducing more and more complicated rules and adjustments to the rules as it goes along. And the problem is the film basically becomes, by the end of it, just constantly explaining new rules to the characters. They have to deal with these the new ways to kind of treat the game. And it gets bogged down in this rather than kind of having the fun of these humiliations and, you know, slightly nasty, you know, limb hammerings and horrible things going on like that that are at the start. It's a pity because the very end of the film, the way in which it ties up how this game is ever going to be closed off, is handled very well. It ends on something very clever, but it gets there by this very, very clumsy route. Another thing that really irritated me about it is that the game of truth or dare that they get involved with these teens is they go on holiday to Mexico and they're coaxed into this abandoned church in Mexico by this lone backpacker, and he's the guy that inducts them into this ritual. And it just seemed incredibly lazy to say, you know, Mexico is this sort of cradle of, you know, ghouls and terrors and, you know, this domain of weirdness that these kids have to go to in order to get infected by this possession. Particularly so recently after a film like Coco, you know, it uses things like the Day of the Dead processions, you know, leaflets flapping around, painted skulls and things. Ooh, what a weird country. And it just feels slightly laboured and cheap. You know, there's no reason they couldn't have been playing this game far closer to home. It also means towards the end of the film, where they go to find clues about this truth or dare game, they have to constantly keep driving back to Mexico. So this slightly ridiculous, you know, frequent flyer style journey over the border, back to the border, over the border, back to the border.
Made a rod for its own back there.
Exactly. But to me, it's the premise is so kind of immediately appealing. Like you said, you know, this just, it sounds like it's going to work and it just doesn't. But you kind of need to go through the film itself to work out why it doesn't.
Right, right.
So a nice try.
A nice try.
From Blumhouse.
No cigar.
And to that, you know, to them it won't matter because there'll just be, you know, there'll be another six Blumhouse films this year at least.
Right. I mean, it's interesting to know about that model. I'd